those of you who don't know me, my name is Anna, and I'm a senior backend developer at PCCW Global, formerly known as Console Connect, here in Brisbane anyway. And I apologize, this was originally a lightning talk, so my slides are really lean, so please use your imagination to insert memes and cool stuff where appropriate. The context for this talk is, for about a decade, I was described as a full stack web developer. So although I sort of knew my way around an API and I'd written some basic API stuff in PHP and Java and Python and later in Node, I hadn't really focused on being an API developer until about a year ago when I started at what was then Console Connect, now PCCW Global, on the API team. So the focus there has been purely as an API developer. So this is a talk that describes that sort of journey of going from what was mostly a full, what was mostly a front-end full-stack role to focusing purely on the back-end. And the appreciation that I've developed for API development in the process. So this is just six strategies that you can use to develop more awesome APIs. So the first one is contract-first development. And this is something I hadn't really heard about until I started at Console. And the idea here is that you develop the contract, that is the description of what the API should do, how the endpoints look, what you can expect that the payloads and the methods and the return values will look like for a given API. Oh no.
Tragically,
screen anymore, so I don't know where it's gone.
It's just because of this, because of the screen share.
Oh, okay, all right, let me get it back.
Is it?
Yeah, I'm an API developer, you can tell, I just don't do front end very well. Full screened it on this screen. Okay, well I'll just make that a little bigger. Hello. Contract first. So the idea of developing the contract before you've actually started writing code. And the reason that this is good is because you are focusing on the design of the API before the implementation. So you get to think about the bigger picture, where your API fits in with all of the rest of your system, how people are going to use it, how to test it, how to deploy it. And really this focuses on one of the important aspects of the API is that it is an application programming interface. So you're talking about the interface between different systems. APIs make the world go round, they're how all of our systems talk to each other. And so you really should be thinking about that contract before you think about anything else, like all the cool stuff about how you're actually going to build it. One of the other things that I've found really useful in the context of agile development is if you deliver that contract at the beginning of a sprint, and say you're all working, the front-end developers, back-end developers, working on the same feature at the same time, it means that I'm not holding up the front-end developers by taking my time implementing the API. I've given them the contract up front so they can be working on it in parallel, which saves a lot of time and also gives us the flexibility of adapting the contract based on developer feedback immediately, which is really cool. So when you are doing contract-first development, one of the great things to do is to create specification documents that describe your contracts. And there are a lot of different tools out there that allow you to do this. You may have heard of Swagger. That's one of the most popular ones, which has been standardized through the Open API group. At Console, we actually use API Blueprint, which is a little bit more manual than Swagger, but we've also started using Swagger. And there are lots of others out there, like RAML, JSON Schema. And if you're really old school and you like W3C standards, you could use WSDL, the Web Services Definition Language, or WADL, the Web Application Description Language. But the important part of this is that you are communicating those contracts to other developers. The other part of developing the contract first is developing docs, or at least skeleton docs that you can give to the developers so they know how to use those endpoints that you've described. And my favorite API docs are the ones that actually use those specifications to generate the docs. The reason for this is you can do things like inject runnable code samples without having to, you know, manually code them up. They're usually structured in such a way that it's much easier to search and navigate them. So instead of reading through an API document like a novel, I just want to go in there and find exactly what I need to know in order to implement that API or to consume it. So being able to search and navigate is really important. It's a reference, not a guide. And the other thing that's cool about generating documentation is that it's automatically up to date, and you can usually have different versions of your docs going at the same time because you just generate a new one whenever you need it, which makes it a lot easier to consistently use that API. So that's the first one was, contract first. The second one, which is closely related to contract first development, is test-driven development. Now, test-driven development is a really great strategy. This is the idea that instead of just rushing in and writing your code, you start by thinking about the problem and then writing some tests that you're going to use to verify whether or not you solved it. Writing the minimal amount of code that you need to make the test pass, and then going back and being clever and refactoring the code, make it cleaner, that sort of thing. Now, test-driven development goes hand in hand with contract-first development because you can be writing your tests at the same time as you're developing your contracts. You don't need to have the code in place to be able to do the testing. And I've found that a lot of the problems that you have with your contracts, the inconsistencies, the incomplete documentation, the gaps in your contracts, can be found when you're setting up your tests, because you pretty much have to go through the steps of using those APIs if you're writing acceptance tests against them. So it means that within the same sprint, you can have validated your contract and fixed it up at that point when it's still within the API team without having sent it out to the other teams. So it's less expensive to fix problems, you know, than it would be if it's already been implemented by, say, two web clients and two mobile clients and so forth. So it's a really great match for contract-first development. But the catch, and I discovered this the hard way, when you're refactoring your code, you also need to refactor your tests, because we ended up in a place where we had thousands of tests, which is awesome in terms of coverage, but it meant that they were taking 7 hours to run, which is, you know, not cool if you're trying to do continuous testing. So you really need to make sure you maintain that high coverage, but constantly going and reusing tests where you can. Don't just write brand new tests for every single feature. Doing benchmarking, doing some profiling of your tests just to make sure that you've got the most efficient tests that you can. And balancing the amount of tests that you have, say, at unit test level against acceptance, against integration. So you should be aiming for a sort of a pyramid of tests, if you like. Lots of unit tests, very few end-to-end tests. So test-driven development was number two. Number three, and this relates to both of those previous 2 points, prioritizing the developer experience. Now, as a front-end developer, I had heard a lot about user experience design, because, you know, you're trying to build front-end systems that users can use and they're intuitive and usable. I did not realize before I started focusing on API full-time that it's equally valid for APIs. Your end users are not front-end users, they're the developers who will be consuming your APIs. So you really need to think about how to build APIs that are not only functional, not only well-documented, but also that are usable. They should be easy to use, they should be a joy to use, because we've all tried to use as front-end developers APIs that are pretty terrible. And what if all of our APIs could be, you know, insane? That would be amazing. So this is something that I've really pushed for in the last year at Consul, is to try to develop the API in a way that's empathetic to the needs of developers. So considering their use cases, considering their needs, just like we would if we were considering the end users, you know, use cases. So understanding those use cases, making it not only possible for them to develop things, but also to make it fast and easy for them to develop those things. And a big part of that is responding to developer feedback in order to eliminate their pain points. So this feeds into the design of the API. Some strategies that I found really useful for designing the API is to use model-based design. So instead of sitting there and thinking about the endpoints and, you know, the paths, the routes in Express terminology that you would use, I think about the models that I want to expose. Because it's much easier for me to think about providing an appropriate level of abstraction and appropriate level of granularity for my end users who are developers when I think about it in terms of models. And then I can actually go in and generate a lot of those endpoints from those models. One of the design principles that we have in our front-end design team at Consul is that design should be as little as possible. So that is, try to produce a minimal solution that meets people's needs, but no more. You don't want to overly complicate it and bloat it. So in terms of API design, that means prioritizing simplicity and clarity in both the documentation and in the models that you're exposing. But one of the things you do need to do when you're planning is to be proactive rather than reactive. So instead of just throwing an extra field on a model because suddenly you have a new requirement, think about where that best fits in so that you can anticipate future requirements. You want to keep your models flexible so that you don't have to change the API too much over time and introduce breaking changes. Sometimes change is necessary. So the thing that you can do there is to try to anticipate the changes as soon as possible, be able to communicate those changes to the developers consuming your APIs so that they know in advance that those changes are coming. So it's a strategy for communication is developing these API docs. Next. Another thing that's really important for the developer experience is cultivating consistency. And this is not only across your API design, but it's also in terms of the code that you write. So we know that coding is usually a team effort. Unfortunately, I've been kind of a team of one for a little while, but in theory, it's a team effort, at least of yourself and your past self and your future self. So I remain hopeful. Oh, by the way, we are hiring. So, you know, I won't be a team of one forever. So please, if you are interested in working on the API at Consul, please come and talk to me, please. So there's a range of individuals contributing to the code base, so you need to be consistent to make it easy to maintain. In the design, so making it easier for the consumers of your API, you would think about things like naming conventions, how you structure your API, so do you have sort of nested routes or is everything flat at the top level? Consistency in terms of the responses that you provide, do you have a standard set of status codes that you use? How do you use your HTTP methods? You know, do you use put for update? Do you use put for create? Do you use post for create? There's different conventions in terms of that. Error handling, and of course versioning. So versioning is actually pretty easy if you stick to something like semantic versioning. Consistency in terms of the way that you code your APIs, well, this is the same as coding in the front end as well. Naming conventions, using consistent style, and I like to use ESLint and editor config to apply a consistent style across my code base. We're using the Airbnb style at Consul. One of the great things about developing a node rather than the front end is that you can use ES6 because you don't have to worry about, you know, with backwards compatibility, so you can kind of move with the times, which is awesome. And also, something that's important is a consistent approach to handling asynchronicity. So do you use promises? Do you use async await? Do you use callbacks? Do you use an async module? I mean, there's lots of different ways that people approach handling async, and if you use a combination of those approaches throughout your code base, it's going to get confusing very quickly. So trying to be consistent there. And also having a consistent approach to logging. So one of the things I learned when I started at Consul was using debug rather than using console.log, because it means that you can set the node debug environment variable and you can filter that log very easily, and that's super cool. And also using logging libraries so that you can do more things with your log outputs. And then also having a consistent environment for development. So we use Docker for our development environment, but also having consistent set of environment variables just to make it easier to keep that config the same across our different systems. And also having a consistent set of scripts for doing things like publishing and testing and that sort of thing without having to have that mental load of how do I run this command. You just know that you can run npm run whatever and it will work in whatever environment you're in. The next thing is probably informed more by the fact that I've been a team of one for about a year rather than API development in general, but work smarter and not harder. So if you have to suddenly do the work of three people, you want to try to automate as much as you can. Sorry, Glenn, I didn't mean to make you nervous. You try to make effective use of your time by optimizing your developer flows as much as you can. So a big one for me has been code generation. So a lot of API endpoints look much the same when you're talking about CRUD routes, create, read, update, delete. And why should I waste my time writing those over and over again? So one of the things that we're doing is moving to Loopback, which is a framework that lets you describe the models, and then it will generate vast amounts of these endpoints that will do everything from create, read, update, delete, querying, filtering, and so forth. So being able to use that, and it also generates the docs as well, has saved a lot of time in developing new features. Automation across all the other processes as well. So any task that's repetitive that you have to do, you know, more than twice, you should probably think about scripting it or automating it, using the tools to the best of their abilities. So using NPMRC, using your package JSON scripts, writing scripts that you can insert in there that will do things like when you publish your code, it updates the Jira tickets, it updates tags on Git, it publishes to Slack or HipChat or whatever you're using. It automates triggering off the tests, you know, using Jenkins or whatever other continuous testing integration server you're using. Using your environment variables also to manage that behavior across different environments. So you can use NodeEmp, for example, with Express to trigger different configs and different behaviors. And also automating things like security checks using the Node Security Project. So I don't really have to worry about doing manual security checks. I just use theirs. The other important aspect of optimizing my developer flow has been mastering my tools. So there's no point in having all these fancy scripts if I'm then doing everything kind of manually in my code editor or manually going to GUIs and clicking around. It's important to take the time to learn the shortcuts in your code editor, your IDE, learn the command line options for the tools that you're using all the time. For me, it's Mocha, Git, Node, and really getting your head around Git as well in terms of understanding the Git workflow that you're using, so that whenever you need to quickly build something, release something, do a hotfix, you're not having to think, how would I do this? How do I backport these changes? It's just all scripted, it's all automatic and easy to do. And the other part of this is keeping your tools up to date as well. If you're using ancient versions of something like Mocha or Node, and then you do need to go and change something and you want to go and look up how to do it, and you have to work out, did it apply to that version, you know, three versions back? So keeping up to date, moving with the times, is really important. And you can use NVM to switch between different versions if you have to support older versions, you know, to do your testing and so forth, but you should be developing on the latest version if you can. All right, and the final tip is development of yourself, not just your code. So developing APIs is not really about the code. A lot of it is about the design. And I found in some ways API development is a lot simpler than front-end development, because all of that crap I had to worry about with different browser versions and stupid workarounds for getting my layout right on the mobile versus the desktop and so forth, I don't have to deal with in the API. My code is much cleaner, much more logical. That gives me more time to think about the actual problems that I'm trying to solve instead of spending 3 days trying to work out why it didn't work in Firefox or Safari. So one of the things that I spend my time now doing is thinking about, can I do things a better way? So I'm always trying to level up in terms of my API development knowledge, looking to do things in a simpler way, in a faster way, make it easier for people to understand, not only people writing in my code base, but also the developers using my API. And this really requires, you know, just like with any other sort of code, professional development, improving your skills, staying up to date. And there are three ways that I like to do that. The first one is what I call code criticism, and criticism in the sense like literary criticism. It's the idea of judging something by its merits and faults. So instead of just like jumping in and writing code from scratch all the time, go and take a look at other people's code. Read through other API docs, particularly for projects that you admire or that are well respected. And actually review that code. Don't just glance at it. Treat it like you were doing a code review for a colleague. There's a lot that you can learn from really inspecting and judging other people's code. And don't just stick to projects that you like. So also look at bad projects so that you've got a point of comparison. If you were a novelist, you probably wouldn't just jump in and start writing a novel, right? You would read other people's work, you'd read reviews, you'd read both bad and good, you know, pulp fiction as well as classics. It gives you a sense of where things fit in the spectrum. So you can learn from the mistakes and the successes of other projects, and also look at other languages. If you're developing in Node, don't be afraid to go read through Java API docs and API code and other paradigms. Not everything is a RESTful API. Go and look at some message bus based APIs. See how they've solved particular problems, you might learn something. The second thing is to experiment. So take those lessons that you've learned from reading other people's code and from seeing what's out there and try it out. Try out tutorials, work on side projects, contribute to open source if you have time and inclination, participate in hackathons, go along to things like Camp.js and do some developer, you know, retreat sort of coding with other people. You will learn so much from your peers. And learning from the community is really what it's all about. So get involved in the community, stay visible. There's not really that many of us who are only doing API development, and you know, remember that it's not all front end. Attend meetups, which you're obviously doing, but also talk at them. So get up and do a lightning talk. Let's hear more from API developers in Bristol.js. And that is pretty much it. That's my 6 ways to an awesome API. Because APIs are awesome and they deserve more love. Thank you.
Very well said. Do we have any questions for Anna?
Yes.
Regarding the slide about code consistency, you were saying about ES6 and other things.
Yep.
Do you use TypeScript at all?
I don't. You know, you have to fit in with what your organization uses. We have not traditionally used TypeScript, so no.
Right. But would you use it personally if it would be?
I would definitely try it out for a small project and see what I thought about it. I know that there have been some vigorous debates here in the past about whether or not it's worth the time, but I think, yeah, keep an open mind.
On the one about being a bit easy in the front end,
yeah.
How do you vertically align an API in a space?
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Yes.
How do you feel now with front-end developers that want to see their point but don't necessarily use what you've used?
So it's a conversation. Sometimes, like, I'm very lucky to work with some excellent front-end developers, not naming anyone, but you know, they don't come to me and say, I need this endpoint, it has to be exactly like this. They'll come to me with some requirements, some user stories, and together we can work on what the API needs to look like to support their needs.
Yeah. What
did
you miss about
front end? Nothing. APIs are awesome. Come join my team. Yeah.
Surely worrying about security and overthinking about how people.
Yeah, we have a security team who actually do take a lot of that off me, and I do use the Node Security Project as well, which is awesome. I think security is a difficult problem, an important problem, but there are a lot of really smart people who are solving it. So I stand on the backs of giants, you know, I don't have to do it all myself. Yeah. Yeah.
Where can we find a job at?
It is on Indeed. Let me pull it up. Give me a second. There it is. Yes. You can just search for PCCW Global, come and talk to me afterwards, talk to Kevin, get in touch via Twitter or anywhere, and yeah, you'll find it. Yes?
In terms of API development, do you recommend any books to...
Oh, that's a tricky one, because books get out of date so quickly, right? No. Thank you.
Thank you very much.